Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Blood on the Razor Wire TV, where we bring it to you real and we bring it to you raw. Hit the subscribe button, hit the like button. We got part two with the officer from Big Sandy. So I'm sure everybody, you know, liked that video. They're tuned in. It's important, man, that we get everyone's perspective on the show, not just, you know, what I think or what some other dude that left prison thinks, but your perspective. So, again, you know, we got David back, and this is part two to our video about Big Sandy. So, David, I want to start by talking about, because, you know, we didn't really get into what happened with my cellmate at the time. His name was Adam Oliveri. He was from New York. We're not going to say who the officer it was, but, you know, he stabbed the CO. And really, he had stabbed the CO because, and I'm going to give you my point of view on it. He had stabbed the CO because the CO had, you know, they felt like the CO was harassing them. He was harassing Stevie from Boston. Stevie was the shot caller for the Boston, New York car. You know, we had an East Coast car there. You know, when I was there, man, we kind of took over. The East Coast car was more powerful. We had more dudes. A lot of the white gang members hated us. But, you know, we handled our business. We do what we had to do. Unfortunately, it's prison. But Adam ended up stabbing the cop because the cop was harassing them, took their wine that day. And it was an ongoing thing. I remember Rios had met with Stevie Burke, and he met with Adam. And, you know, a few days later, man, after they had met with the warden, well, probably about 2-3 weeks later, you know, he ended up stabbing the officer. Do you remember when that happened?
I do.
Tell me what you guys knew about it, man, how that happened.
It wasn't as far as knowing about it up front, but now as time went on by, you know, it came out that they knew it was coming and they didn't let him know that. Then after it happened, they're like, you know, we'll take care of you. We'll take care of you. And he was done pretty dirty over his career. He was not taken care of.
So let me ask you this. You said they knew that he was going to get stabbed. Who was they? The administration?
The overheads, what the word was. They knew it was coming, SIS.
And the people that ran that prison at the time was Lineweaver. She was the AW at the time. Do you remember her, Miss Lineweaver?
I do. Now, I don't know who knew specifically. I just know it's a fairly well-known fact that, you know, the overhead in general knew it was coming, didn't tell him, didn't pull him. And after it happened, you know, you get stabbed, that'll mess you up mentally. You know, it has to, you know.
Oh, I'm sure.
Now, he was told he'd be taken care of, you know, but now he wasn't.
What did they mean by taking care of him? What did they mean? What do you think they were going to do? Take care of him financially?
Come out that it was, you know, a known thing. You know, they're like, they pretty much could own that place. And they're like, oh, don't do this, don't do that. We'll take care of you. And, you know, they didn't. And he ended up retiring as a friggin', you know, pay grade 7, you know.
GS7?
After that happened, he should have been given, you know, they should have done better by him.
And you, well, you know, I'm going to say this, right? And some people that are watching, they might not, you know, like what I'm going to say. You know, we talked about how, you know, guards are in prison and, you know, some guys just come to do their job, man, and men respect men. But I, you know, that officer, I mean, I'll be honest with you, man, I was in the housing unit with him. That guy was kind of hard, man. He did some things that maybe he shouldn't have been doing either, you know? And I don't mean illegal stuff. I just mean constant harassment. Okay, it's against the rules to drink. You don't want people drinking because we know what happens when people get drunk in prison. They start, you know, most of the time, they start, you know, getting beer muscles and they stab people. They fight. They, you know, create assaults. We had an incident in the unit where, you know, a white dude was calling, you know, some of the black prisoners, you know, racial names. And, you know, we had to handle that. I was part of handling that, man. And I remember, you know, doing what we did to the dude in the cell. He came out. He's bleeding and stuff. He goes to the bottom of the steps and he looks up at us and he says, you know, look what you white bitches did to me. And then, you know, he ran out of the unit, ran to the cop. But, you know, sometimes there are cops in there that go above and beyond, man. Do things, they'll go search your cell, destroy it, leave it messed up. And dudes get angry about that.
Yeah, they, you know, you're technically, you're supposed to, once you search a cell, you're supposed to, time permitting, you're supposed to put stuff back as you found it. You know, you're not supposed to just toss it and leave it. You know, like you see on TV and stuff. Now, I'm not sure how like state prisons and such is, but when you toss a cell, you're supposed to, time permitting, you know, unless something's, you know, your attention's got to be somewhere else right then, put it back how you found it.
Yeah, I mean, that's what the policy says, but we know that, man, you know, there's unwritten rules, right? I mean, Have you ever seen, let's be honest here, let's shoot straight. Have you ever seen, you know, where there's a guy in prison where, you know, the cops think he's an asshole? Maybe even the prisoners think the guy's an asshole, right? And, you know, guys go in there and just destroy people's cells and leave it that way? You ever seen that?
Not that I've personally ever seen. If I searched it or anybody I worked with searched it, no. No, you know, you spend, you know, you're supposed to do, you know, however many cell searches a day. You spend about 5 minutes. You know, I'd look and, you know, I try to put stuff back as best I could. And most of the people that I know or I worked with did too. You know, I ain't saying it didn't happen. I'm sure it did. But, you know, it's just not something that, you know, was around me.
So you were working there when Adam stabbed the cop. Do you remember, you know, what was the sentiment from the guards at that time where people were like, oh, shit, this. And Adam was a big dude, man. And he was a tough dude. He was serving 40 years. He really didn't care. He was already in prison for murder. I mean, was there kind of like people that were like, oh, man, you know, like, dude, are we going to start getting stabbed now where people aren't respecting the cops to the point where they would just start stabbing people, stabbing cops?
I don't think it was that. I mean, I think people knew going in that was a real possibility. You know, that could have happened, I guess, at anybody at any time. Anybody could have been having a bad day and that could have happened to you. And I think people, you know, they were well aware of that. You know, that's just one of the dangers of, you know, working in that type of prison.
It's a dangerous environment, man. You know, we all know that, right? Walking in there. I mean, you're working with guys that got nothing to lose. They've already got life. What could you possibly do to a guy that's got a life sentence already? What consequences are there?
Yeah, I mean, the worst thing that's going to happen is they go to the ADX and, you know, there they get a TV and left alone. So there's some people that want to go there, you know. I mean, I wouldn't be one of them, but there's some that do.
I've been around dudes like that, man. Sometimes you just get fed up and you're like, I'll just go over here. I had a dude, man, in my unit when I was in Arizona. He stabbed this young dude in the neck, almost killed him. And I asked him, I said, why would you do that, man? Dude had like 18 months left. Why would you do something like that? And that's exactly what he told me. He said, man, I just want to go to ADX, get my own TV. I seen him in the shoe. He said, I want to watch American Idol. I said, you stabbed the dude so you could go watch American Idol on your own TV? Are you kidding me? You know, I know you came on the show. It's probably taboo for some people because, you know, I've been in prisons where, you know, some guards have been, you know, they've been all right to people, man. Some of them have been overly nice at times. And, you know, they've been accused of being inmate lovers by other staff, stuff like that. I mean, I'm sure that you've seen this, man. Have you ever seen stuff like that?
Anybody that I called, you know, friend or worked around, you know, they were pretty straight shooters. You know, they respect whoever and whoever respects them. You know, they ain't sweating the small stuff. You know, they're just good, normal people. You know, I think the majority of the staff is, and there's just, no matter what you do, whether you work in a prison, you're a cop, you work at Walmart, there's just going to be a few bad ones.
Yeah, I mean, there's always a few bad apples in everything, right? No matter where you work at, whether you're a cop, a prison guard, you know, you might, a mechanic. I mean, that just comes with life. Let me ask you this. Being that you worked at Big Sandy, what is the most gruesome thing that you've ever seen that you can remember? And I know you've seen a lot of bad stuff because you were overseas, you know, you fought for the country, you know, you were in the military. But what was one of the worst things you ever seen at Big Sandy?
Probably, and it's something I'm sure it's happened many, many times there, was a guy stepping out of the shower and his own people, and he was a shot caller for the unit, and his own people just drilling him in the head with a lock and a sock. And, it, you know, that does some damage, a whole lot more than what you'd think. And it just laid his head open bad. And, you know, and it probably wasn't the most bloody or gruesome thing, but it's just the look on his face when it happened, you know, it's a nasty thing.
That's something that people in the public probably don't even realize. And some of the kids that are watching the show right now that, you know, are out here selling drugs, committing crimes, doing carjackings, robbery. They don't understand that when you get to prison, man, that, you know, these things happen. And a lot of people think probably a knife is even worse. But from your perspective and my perspective, too, and I've seen plenty of people hit with locks and stabbed, man, that lock does some serious damage.
I can absolutely split your head. I mean, it's a vicious weapon.
And some people might think if you just put it in a sock, it'll fly out. But really what we do in there is we tie it. We click the lock, and then we tie it with a sock or tie it with one of the BOP belts. And that's, you know, that's when you go to work on a guy. And I seen a guy when I was in USP Lee. This dude was raping this dude. He was from Louisiana. He was raping this younger kid from North Carolina. And the North Carolina kid had enough of it. He waited till the move. And he hit the guy on the move outside that was raping him. And he hit him with that lock and completely knocked him out. Remember, the dude was just laying out on the ground. So, you know, the locks are dangerous. I'm going to actually make some weapons, man, and have a show on it so people can see, you know, how gruesome these weapons are. I'm sure you've seen some pretty dangerous weapons in there, right?
Oh, yeah, you see some 8-9-inch just bone crushers come out of there, you know, just sharp, pointed, you know, just about like you went and bought them at the store. I mean, people take time to make them knives.
You know, one
they kill you easily.
You know, one thing that I say is that, you know, prisoners, when you see some of these prisoners, they're innovative, man. Some prisoners can just do, they make things that you guys are probably like, damn, I don't care if it's a drawing, if it's a weapon, if they're moonshining. You see prisoners really like MacGyver, right?
Well, some of the skill of tattoo work I've seen, you know, most people there, and that's, I don't really remember back then, but, you know, most people don't sweat the tattooing. You know, if you get in a unit, they're going to come ask you, do you care if we tattoo? And my thing was, you know, I'd rather you do that than make a little envelope and put needles on it so I didn't get poked. Like, here's your little envelope full of tattoo needles. I know it's there when I'm searching. I don't run the risk of getting poked and you all tattooed.
Yeah. I respect that. You know, there's, you know, a lot of guys operate that way. A lot of cops are like, hey, it's better to ask and do something than, you know, not ask and disrespect you guys. You guys don't like to be disrespected either, right?
No, you know, and I don't think anybody does, you know, man, woman. You know, nobody wants to be just blatantly disrespected. You know, I understand everybody has bad days, but, you know, nobody just wants a, you know.
Yeah. Hey, I asked you this the other day, I think, but I want to talk a little bit about Ace, Warren Back. I'll throw his name out there. It doesn't matter. He's dead now. You didn't work there when he was shot from the tower, right? They shot him with an AR-15 through the back, blew his guts out. You weren't working there then, were you?
What year and month was it?
October 2009. I think you were gone. Did you ever hear about that incident? He was out there stabbing the dude on the yard. They fired a couple warning shots. And I think Mr. Brown either shot him. He was the counselor. Or Mr. Brown was in the hospital with him. He ended up becoming my counselor. He was a rec specialist. But do you remember hearing about that incident when they shot him through the back? The nurse was actually on the ground trying to push his guts back into his stomach and get the dirt off his guts and push him back. Is that the same story you heard?
Similar.
You know, some of these people don't realize, man, in Big Sandy, they will shoot you. Will they not?
They will. And, you know, during the last video after it, a few people reached out to me and they wanted me, and I ain't going to say no names or anything because, you know, they're still working there. And they wanted me to discuss some issues. Now, I'm not going to say what's in those towers or protocols or anything. I can't say that. But I do know, like, you could be assigned to work that tower. And, you know, and that's a pretty good stretch. If you're in the middle tower and at the end of whatever field, that's, you know, that's a pretty good shot. And, you know, you don't, those rifles ain't zeroed to you. They're not zeroed to the shooter. So they're putting you in a situation where you could potentially have to take a small percentage shot and you didn't get a zero of the rifle.
So, but I want the people that are listening and kids to know this, that, you know, policy allows the guards to shoot people. If, you know, they go a certain, you know, they fire a warning shot, you don't listen, because at the end of the day, your job is safety and security of the facility, right?
Yep. You can absolutely, you know, if they go through the steps, and like I said, I can't say what they are, but if they go through the steps and then, you know, they're still going at it, you know, you'll be shot. You know, nobody wants to shoot anybody, but, you know, they'll pour it to it.
Don't think any of them guys want to shoot a guy once in a while?
I certainly hope not. I mean, I don't think I've, you know, been put in that situation several times, and, you know, it's something that I don't ever want to do or have any hankering to do.
Well, I mean, I don't want to just shoot people, but I'm sure there's been times in my life where I was like, man, I wouldn't mind shooting that son of a gun right there. I'm just being honest with you, man. Because there's been some people I've been in prison with where I said, God, if I had AR-15, I'd light this whole damn day room up. Just because there's some ignorant people in there when you get to the lower levels, you know what I mean? And I do care about people, man. I do have compassion. But there's some dudes in there where you're just like, and I'm sure you've seen it. You've worked in housing units. You know, how loud is it in there sometimes?
Well, sometimes it can be extremely loud. You know, and I mean, you know, hollering, yelling, you know, if it's midday and, you know, it's, then the unit's packed, you know, it's loud, and they echo bad.
Yeah. So when you go home from prison, right, you work in that prison all day, you work your 8 hours, however many hours you work, you go home. Did you leave the job at the door, or did you sometimes take it home?
I left it at the door, but like I said, I'd been used to a lot of that. But, you know, you take people that's worked in there 10, 15, 20 years, and they've seen just untold amounts of violence and blood and gore. You know, the BOP should focus more on the mental health of the staff member. And I know that, you know, about the inmate too, because they see it as well. But, you know, it's like they don't, you know, they should really focus on the people that, you know, stay in these housing units for 10, 15, 20 years working, you know, cleaning up the blood and the guts and the gore, you know, but they don't. So a lot of times they'll turn to the bottle as the only way to cope, you know, and really they need a reprieve, they need counseling, they need help.
A lot of guards die young, don't they? I was reading them statistics.
It's a pretty common thing. You know, you're in a stressful situation, you know, the entire 8, 10, 16 hours, whatever you're working, your cortisol levels are high, everything's high, you're stressed out. You know, it's hard to drop that at the door.
I understand. Believe me, I was there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for almost 18 years. So the same way that it affects guards, it probably affects the prisoners too, you think?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
The difference is you guys get to go home at night. Some of us don't, you know, not some, a lot of us don't, all of us don't. Eventually, some of us make it out. Some guys don't. Some guys got life. But I think it affects everybody, you know, and I want to ask you this. I think prison, you know, I went to prison, man. I was a drug dealer. I made some irrational, irresponsible choices that I deeply regret today. Believe me when I tell you that. It's not just for the camera. I regret the choices that I made that led to me going to prison. But I feel like prison and Big Sandy specifically helped blacken my heart, man. There was a part of me where I feel like my heart was blackened. I stopped liking people. I like animals more than people. I've said it on videos because just when you see the gruesome stuff that people do, there's a part that blackens your heart. You become immune to a certain point to violence. You're just like, damn, man, they stabbed that dude. Oh, well. I mean,
dude. I think you have to detach yourself, you know, to a certain degree. And that's why a lot of divorce rates are high. Not everybody, you know, it affects people differently, but, you know, it's just a hard thing to get used to. It does affect people. I think they should be, you know, more mental health, you know, for staff and inmates.
I understand that too. And I understand, you know, people don't want you to go to prison and have a great time. But if you look at somebody's prisons in other countries, right, like Sweden and that Michael Moore, I don't really care for that dude, but he did a documentary, Who Do We Invade Next? And he went into these other prisons in European countries. And you looked at these prisons, and those prisons were really focused on rehabilitation. And, you know, we got an Eighth Amendment, you know, right here against cruel and unusual punishment, right? But I think that we live in a society where everybody feels like we got to hammer these people. We got to be nasty to these people. You know, they're felons, they're criminals, they're, you know, they're scumbags. And I feel that people really feel that way. But if we did things a little bit different as far as rehabilitation, I think it would benefit not only the prisoners, but also the people that work in the prison, not just guards, but wardens and school teachers and law librarians, you know, the people that, you know, the kitchen workers. I mean, I think it would change things if we actually approach this on a rehabilitative, you know, platform.
My personal opinion, the only people that should be in a prison like Big Sandy, child molesters, killing kids, killing people, rapists, beating your spouse for years on years, people like that, the worst of the worst, the absolute scum of this earth. Everybody else, because you're not getting rehabilitated in a maximum level prison. You're just not in this country. You're absolutely not. I think there should be other programs, other ways, you know, at least, you know, if it's a first offense thing, you know, or the first serious thing, like you cross state lines with drugs, you know, I think there should be a way that they could, you know, try to give you a chance to say, hey, let's try to help this dude. Let's don't ruin his record. Let's don't slap him with a felony. Let's do something to try to get him back, you know, into society doing good.
I agree with you. I think that should be our aim, because that's what we talk about, but we just don't do it. You know what I mean? We just don't do it. It's not our focus isn't really rehabilitation. That's what we tell people. You know, that's what the policy says. That's what the judges say when they sentence people. And people have to realize that there are guys in Big Sandy that are nonviolent drug offenders. There are some white collar guys in there, man, that got 30, 40 years. You know, should they be in that environment? Probably not.
No, that's why I don't agree with the crack laws. You know, like the crack laws of people way back in the late 80s, early 90s, you know, caught with crack, you know, boom, 40 years, boom, life. You know, when, you know, the difference in, you know, if you was caught with coke instead of crack, you'd have got 5. But, you know, you got hit with crack, you're going for 30 or 40.
Well, they're trying to change that now. They did a little bit, but there's a whole lot more to do with that, you know. So I know you said some of the guards reached out to you. Do you think the guards feel like they're mistreated there, that they deserve a little more than what they're getting?
I think, and I, a lot of times the run of these prisons, you know, from the AWs, and I don't mean like from the captain down, you know, I mean like the real higher echelons of these prisons, they may not have come up through the custody side of things. So they institute programs, policy, and stuff that, you know, it may be them that's running the prison bad. Well, you know, your leaders, the leadership dictates, you know, morale and everything else. I think from the captain, lieutenants down, you know, they don't have much of a choice about how things are implemented. They just have to implement it. So, yeah, I think they get stepped over a lot when they should really value their opinion, because they're the ones that do it every day.
I agree with that. From a prisoner's perspective, I agree with that. You know, I used to say in prison, even about other dudes and gang members, I say, man, show me your leader. I'll tell you about your people, right? Because it starts from the top. And I believe that because, you know, when you got a guy that worked in security, you know, he came up the levels, that's where he started, instead of some dude that's sitting in an office making policy, they understand prison. They understand what's really going on. They know what you have to do, man, what you're supposed to give to the prisoners. Instead of all these bullcrap rules like the 300 minutes a month on the phone. Oh, well, the phones will be packed. There'll be fights. That's nonsense. It's just a way to smash people. So when you come from the security perspective, and there was a lieutenant that worked there, and I respect him. The dude hit me when I was out there fighting with Ace and them. He hit me so hard, man, he knocked my shoe off. He was an older guy. He stepped on my neck. He picked me right up off the ground. But you know what? I respected that dude. He reminded me of someone like one of my uncles. But he knew how to deal with people, man. I don't care if you were black, Hispanic, white. He knew how to deal with you. And if you had something coming, like you said the other day, you got it. If you didn't, then you didn't get it. And sometimes, you know, some of them guys are a little lenient. They'll give a little. But, you know, you got to give a little on both sides, on our side and on your side. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. I don't think if you tried to run that prison, you know, 100% to where, you know, anything that you're able to write a shot for, you wrote it. That's all you'd ever do. That prison would be a miserable place to work or to live or anything else. I'm sure it's miserable to live there anyways. But, I mean, there would be a lot more at that prison than what happens already. You have to, you know, it's a give and take game, and you have to play that game.
There it is. It's a give and take. Let's talk about, there's something else I really want to talk about, right? Were you working there when they started putting two officers in every unit? And they started giving you guys stab vests?
Yeah, the second time, yeah. There was two in.
Let me ask you this. Now that you got two officers in the unit, right? And they did that because, you know, we know why they did that. The officer was killed in Canaan. Sorry that happened, but it happened. I mean, this is the reality. This is, you know, that could have been that officer, that guard when I was in Big Sandy, when Adam stabbed him. It could have been him. But, you know, years later, it was that officer, and there's other officers that died in the line of duty. So now that you had two officers in the unit, did you feel a little more safer?
I didn't feel safer. I felt as though, you know, well, yeah, I mean, if you got jumped on one side of the unit, they could, you know, hit the radio or whatever. So, yeah, it helped out a little bit that way. But, you know, it allowed, you know, when there was a movement, one could be inside, one could be outside. So, you know, if something was going on, say they drug somebody back into a cell, you know, somebody could be in there to watch. Because before that, you couldn't. You know, that's why a lot of stuff happened on moves. The stab vest, you know, if you're wearing a vest and nobody knows it, it's one thing. But if people know you got it on and they go to stab you, you know, they're probably going to go for, you know, something up in there. You know, that's a guaranteed bad day.
No, I understand that, but Let me tell you something. In the heat of the moment, you know, I've seen dudes stabbed 20, 30 times, and I know you've seen it, and they didn't die. And you've probably seen dudes stabbed one time and died.
It's just a bad luck of the draw. You know, you could be stabbed in the neck and live, stabbed in the heart and live, and then stabbed and it just happened to clip your femoral and bleed out.
You ever worry about getting stabbed in there? Keep it real, man. Because I worried about it and I was a prisoner.
Sure, I think you have to worry about it. You know, I think you have to, you know, watch yourself. You know, you can't get too comfortable in a you know, a situation like that. You kind of got to mind your P's and Q's. But that's why, you know, you treat men like men, and generally they'll treat you back the same way. But, yeah, absolutely. If anybody says they didn't worry about getting stabbed or a bunch jumping on them that works there, they're probably lying. They're lying to themselves if they believe that.
How about, let me ask you this, how about pipes? You ever seen any steel rebar in there? You know, people that got little pipes to whack people with. You ever seen those?
No, I've never seen any rebar weapons. I've never found them or seen them personally. But now they figured out ways to, like, get through certain walls and, you know, and hide hoops and stuff. How they've done it, I have no idea. But, you know, they can figure it out.
Oh, 100%. I was there when one of the dudes in our car ripped all the ripped steel rebar out of the kitchen and somehow made it back with the steel rebar. So I want to ask you a couple more questions before we go and then let you, you know, say what you want to say. Let me ask you this. Do you remember the ABTs, the Aryan Brotherhood of Texas? Do you remember them guys? Do you remember the guy that we won't say his real name, but we'll refer to him as his prison name, Dinky. Do you remember Dinky? He was the shot caller for the ABTs. Little short, scraggly looking white dude, long hair, lived in A2. Do you remember that guy?
No, right off the end of them.
Okay. Well, anyway, he ended up getting out of prison, and now he's back with a life sentence in the state of Texas. Real dirtball. I just wanted to know if you remembered him. So I know you want to say a couple things before we close. I want you to know that I appreciate you coming on the show and giving your perspective and, you know, the perspective from that side, from the guard side, too, because, listen, man, you know, not all guards are horrible. You know, there's some dudes in there that just come there to do their job, and I respect that. It's the ones that come in there that want to be assholes, destroy your cell, you know, act tough, talk shit to you that I don't like. But before we close the show, you know, I know you got some things you want to say. So now's your time. Say them.
You know, I'd like to, you know, this is for like the exec staff, the overhead, you know, take care of your people. You know, the custody staff is, you know, who works that prison, you know, take care of them. You know, a lot of money flows into other programs, but it should be flowing there. You know, the training should be flowing there. And for people that work there, and even people that get out of there, that are inmates there, you know, keep up with your mental health. You know, after years of seeing that stuff for that long, you know, it's going to, whether you think it does or not, it affects you. You know, whether it's affecting you right then or affects you later or affects you when you get home, it does affect you. It will affect you. You know, and, you know, just definitely take care of your people there and, you know,
don't try to burn them for doing their jobs.
And they will. Hey, it's a dirty game in there. They will burn the guards behind your back.
You know, and there's, like I say, 95% of people that work there are just good, solid people trying to take care of their families. But, you know, the other 5% that are dirty, that are corrupt, that are bringing stuff in, and I'm sure that you knew of a few when you were there that was doing it. You know, they're really what, you know, makes it bad and dangerous. And, you know, and for the overhead as well, when it comes to promotion, you know, promote the people that do the work. Don't promote the people that are just kissing your butt.
I respect that because I said that about criminal justice reform advocates. These people are running down to the White House acting like they're doing all this stuff for people, but all they're looking for is media clips and kissing people's asses to try to, you know, move up the ladder in the criminal justice world. So, hey, man, again, I appreciate you for coming on. And any kids that are watching this, I want you to see this. I want you to know that these things happen. I want you to know that you could be stabbed in prison. You could die. Someone could call your mother and say, listen, I'm sorry to tell you, your son was doing a 9-year sentence and he was in Big Sandy. He shouldn't have been here. But you know what? That's where the BOP sent him. And now your son is dead. You know, you think you're out here selling drugs. It's nonviolent. You might get 4 or 5 years. You're probably mistaken. And even if you got 4 or 5 years, you could still end up in Big Sandy where they're killing people, where the guards will shoot your ass from the tower. You will lose your life there. And that's why it's called Blood on the Razor Wire, because there's plenty of people that lost their blood, man. It was left on the razor wire. I don't want it to be yours. Hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, Blood on the Razor Wire TV.